Hi, and thanks for joining us. Here at Live Free Church, we're empowering people to live a life of freedom through Jesus Christ. So, get ready to hear a life-changing and life-empowering message from our guest speaker.
Praise God. Welcome to Live Free Live. What a mighty God we serve. Amen. I think I'll sing a little bit of that. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. The angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty God we serve. God bless you. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Those that are here with me, come on, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. We are excited today, for this is the day that the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. I feel like preaching today. I feel like declaring the word of God today. We're going to just let the Holy Ghost have his way. Is that all right today? Thank you for tuning in wherever you are. Our pastors are so delighted that you have tuned in to share with us, amen, in this service on today. We are excited that the church is about to open back up. Oh, my God. We're just going to have a grand good time. But we're going to continue to keep our online experience going as well. But we're just excited today because God has a word just for you. Point to yourself and say, God's going to speak to me today. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's go to the book of Matthew. The book of Matthew, the 14th chapter. And we're going to start at the 22nd verse. I don't even need to pray because Minister Sabrina tore it up. Come on here. There's no demon that could survive that prayer. Come on. Hallelujah. There's no way any demons are in this place or in your home because she cast them all out. Hallelujah. Now we are at liberty to enjoy the word of the Lord. Matthew 14, verse 22 down to 33, and it reads, "And straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship, to go before him unto the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. And when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. But the ship was now in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went walking unto them on the water." Verse 26, "And when the disciples saw him walking on the sea," because he's that bad. Come on here. Jesus is bad. Hallelujah. Michael Jackson ain't got nothing on Jesus. Come on here. "Jesus was walking on the sea, and they were troubled, saying, 'It is a spirit.' And they cried out for fear," because God sometimes can come to you and you'll call it the devil. So we got to be very careful in that because he ain't going to always come the way you think he should come. "But straightway," verse 27, "Jesus spake unto them, saying, 'Be of good cheer.'" Hallelujah. It's a season to rejoice. It's a season to be happy. It's a season to smile. Ain't no time to hold your head down. We are the children of the Most High God. He said, "Be of good cheer." Also is translated, "Be of good courage." Have courage. "It is I. Be not afraid." "And Peter answered him and said, 'Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come unto thee on the water.' And he said, 'Come.' And when Peter was come down out of the ship," because sometimes you got to separate from folk if you're going to go where God trying to take you. You can't always hang with the chickens if you're called to be an eagle. Who am I talking to this morning? So he got down out of the ship and he walked on the water to go to Jesus. "But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink and cried, saying, 'Lord, save me.' And immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand." Come on here. "Immediately Jesus stretched forth his hand and caught him and said unto him, 'O thou of little faith.'" Ain't you glad God don't have to believe completely for God to deliver you? Sometimes you can be in doubt and his mercy is so good, he'll still bring you out. "O thou of little faith, Where did you doubt? Sometimes we need to go back to where we start believing, where we stop trusting. That's the problem. That's the root. It's not your husband. It's not your dog. It's not your cat. It's not your boss. It's where you stop believing. That was a word for somebody. Verse 32 says, and when they were coming to the ship, the wind ceased. And then they that were in the ship came and worshiped him, saying, of truth, thou art the Son of God. Let's go back up to verse 24. Verse 24, but the ship was in the midst of the sea, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. Today I want to talk to you about overcoming contradictions. The wind was contrary. Hallelujah. Have you ever had to deal with contrary winds? Some of you dealing with it right now, contrary. That means it's going in the opposite, to oppose. That's what that word contradict means, to oppose, to push against, to be uncooperative, to go in opposite in direction. Is your situation going in the opposite direction? Is your relationship going in the opposite direction? You used to be in love, but now you don't know what's going on because there's contradictions arising. Your money used to be high, but now your bank account saying if you go do one more transaction, you're going to be in the red. Come on here. But God wants you to overcome contradictions. Today is your day of salvation. Today is your day of deliverance. I believe that the word is so powerful. I believe that if you just speak the word only, you can be made whole. I don't even need to lay hands on you. When Peter preached his trial sermon on the day of Pentecost, the Bible says that the Holy Ghost filled all that heard him preach. Hallelujah. That heard the word. When you get God's word in your spirit, it will change everything. Hallelujah. It will change the course of your situation. So we see Jesus is out here. He sent the disciples ahead of him. The last time I preached from this text, it was in the book of Mark. And I believe I was preaching on the subject that we need to ride out the storm. Come on here. We need to ride out the storm. And God said, go back to that text because I got to deal with something else in that same text. See, God is so, amen, diverse that he don't just stop with one thing. He can take the same thing and get 100 things out of it. Come on here. He can take you and get 100 gifts out of you. God is so diverse like that. So now he's want us to deal, amen, with verse 24. For the wind was contrary. Let me get straight into it. I don't even want to go into no whole type of introduction, no wow bow introduction. I want to go straight into the matter. Let's dig into this text. Let's talk about the four important facts about walking with God. If you decide you're going to walk with God, and most of us have. We decide. If you tuned in, you're walking with God. And even if you're not walking with God, you are walking with God because in him you live, in him you move and have your being. You could do nothing without him. That's John 15 and 5. Without me, Jesus said, you can't do nothing. So I know you think that you're on your own, but you're not your own. You have been bought for and paid for with a price. His name is Jesus. He the one shed that blood for you. He the one took those 40 stripes on your behalf. He the one, hallelujah, that's blessed your life and given you the air to breathe right now. If it wasn't from him waking you up this morning, tapping you on your shoulder, you would have stayed prostrate in your bed. Hallelujah. And they would have brought in the morgue folk and they would have rolled you out. But because he touched you, and you didn't even say thank you, but because he's so good, he'll touch you anyhow. Hallelujah. That word overcome means to succeed in dealing with a problem or difficulty, to conquer. That's what we're going to do today. We're going to overcome. Hallelujah. And we're going to overcome these contradictions. But let's talk about these four important facts about walking with God. Number one, don't always expect change to come conveniently. Verse 22 says, and straightway Jesus constrained the disciples to get into a ship. That means he forced them to do it. Sometime if God left it up to us, we wouldn't make the decision. We wouldn't do what God wants us to do. We wouldn't go where God wants us to go. Sometime God has to put a little fire under us to get us to do what he's called us to do, to get us to act right, to do right, to be right, to love right, to go right. Sometime he'll constrain you. Things don't always come conveniently. Hallelujah. You're going to walk with God. You got to be ready. Hallelujah. To be flipped and turned. He is the potter and you are the clay. He the one molding and making you. And when you're marred, he don't give up on you. He'll keep spinning you till he spin you right. Oh, hallelujah. God is in the business of making you his vessel of honor. Genesis 32, 24 says, and Jacob was left alone. And there he wrestled. Come on here. Life is a wrestling match. Where you at, Mother Carmen? Life is a wrestling match. Sometimes you got to get on the ropes and fight the devil. Sometimes you got to throw a chair at him. Sometimes, amen, you got to do a flip. Whatever you got to do, you got to fight the good fight of faith. Because change ain't always going to come conveniently. Sometimes if you're going to get a change, you're going to have to rebuke demons. Hallelujah. You're going to have to go fasting. You're going to have to pray. Sometimes you're going to have to cry. Sometimes you're going to have to stay up all night. Sometimes you're going to have to shut yourself away. But oh, if you want to change, sometimes it ain't going to come easy. He constrained him. Get into this boat. Go before me on the other side, while he sent the multitudes away. That leads me to my second fact about walking with God. Isolation often precedes promotion. Come on here. He sent the multitudes away. I'm finna talk to somebody and give you a prophetic word. You got too many people in your life. You got too many people in your circle. God can't take you to the next level until you divorce some folk. I ain't talking about your spouse. Help me, Jesus. Till you divorce some folk. You got to divorce some folk. There's some folk in your life that don't mean you no good. And you know they don't mean you no good. And you wondering why you can't get where you're going. It's because you need to go. Let them go so you can go forward. But if you're going to go with God trying to take you, sometimes he'll put you by yourself. The Bible says he sent the multitudes away and he went up into a mountain apart to pray. Not with everybody else, apart. Some people act like they can't survive without somebody there. Somebody praying for them and with them. Somebody's greeting them and somebody's hugging. No, sometimes when God is ready to move in your life, when he's ready to take you and give you a revelation, give you an understanding, give you a dream, give you a vision, give you a purpose, he'll put you by yourself. He'll put you all by yourself. The Bible said in Isaiah 51 and 2, looking to Abraham, your father, and Sarah that bore you, for I called him alone and blessed him. Not saying that he's not going to restore you back into relationships. You are around a whole lot of people. Have you ever been in a crowd and still felt alone? Have you ever been married and still felt alone? Let me tell you single folks something. You don't have to worry about being alone because there's some married folk right now that are laying right next to each other feel like they're laying by themselves. But even in that, God still said, I could even take that and turn it into good. But you need to understand that if you are married, you're supposed to be one in the eyes of God, not two. Come on here. He said, I made you one flesh. Number three, the third fact about, amen, walking with God is that God's glory rises through risk takers. Ooh, I got a spin on that one. Come on. Oh, hallelujah. Let me do one more. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. God is ready to move in somebody's life, but you too quiet. You too, amen. You too, you know, your comfort zone is too good. Sometimes God has to put you in a situation where you have to just take a step. Oh, hallelujah. If you're sitting in a house with somebody, if you're sitting in this church next to somebody, would you just look at them and tell them, take a step. God is waiting on you to take a step. step. You've been waiting on God, but God's been waiting on you. He's given you power to tread upon them serpents. He's given you power to take a step. He's given you the authority to go for what you know. Go for it. Quit sitting back and say, I got to get a little more educated. I got to get a little better. I got to get my hair did. I got to get my toes did. No, you got to go. Hallelujah. Somebody say go. Verse 28 says, and Peter answered him and said, Lord, if it's you bid me to come. Oh, you don't see, when you pray, you better be ready to hear what God's going to say. If you're going to take the time to say, Lord, help me, you better get ready for an answer. Come on here, because he's going to answer, and the answer ain't always what you expect. Lord, if it's you bid me to come. And he said, what? Come. And when Peter was come out of the water, out of the ship, he walked on the water to go to Jesus. He did the same thing Jesus did. Who am I here preaching to right now? Jesus even said, the works that I do, you're going to be able to do also. And greater works than these shall you do. Because why? I'm going to the Father. Why would you be my child and I don't give you power to walk on water? Why would you be my child and miracles, signs, and wonders don't follow you? You are my child. Take a risk. Somebody want to open a business, but Corona whispering in your ear saying you better not. Ain't nobody gonna come there. Hallelujah. You want to come back to church, but Corona whispering in your ear, you bet not. You might get me. Hallelujah. You want to go to work, but Corona whispering in your ear, you bet not. You might get to Corona, but you need to tell Corona, if Jesus said come, I'm gonna come. I don't care what the rest of the world gonna do. You can sit there and be cute all you want. You can stay on the boat. Can you imagine all the other 11 disciples on the boat looking at Peter? Because God will give them a show. It's showtime. They believe me. It's showtime. I'm going to show you a miracle. And old brother Peter, because he trusts me. He took a risk. He stepped out of something that was holding him back. And he stepped into something that I'm about to raise him up in. Is anybody ready for God to arise in you? Take a risk. You can't take a risk and be cute. Quit being enamored and amazed by all the risk takers. Can you imagine him? Ooh, look at Peter. He's walking on the water. If Peter was black, he'd be like, yeah. Yeah. You know? You know? Hallelujah. If he was a little Caucasian brother, he'd probably, you know. Hallelujah. But no matter what Peter was doing, he was on top of that thing. Hallelujah. Get on top of it. Quit being scared of it and get on top of it. Number four. Got to move on. My time is approaching. Come on. Number four. The fourth fact about walking with God. I like this one. When you obey God, he will not let you down. Come on here. Woo. He won't let you down. Look at verse 30 and verse 31. But when he saw the wind boisterous, he was afraid and beginning to sink. Huh? Sister Pam, he was beginning to sink. He had begun to sink. Can I give a word to somebody? He began to sink, but he did not finish. Oh, hallelujah. And no, don't worry about if you begin to sink. That ain't the issue, but hallelujah. The problem would be if you go all the way under and don't come back up. But long as you're beginning, God can save you. Long as there's a problem, he can fix it. Long as you got breath in your body, he can heal you. He began to sink, but he cried. Said, Lord, save me. And immediately, what did Jesus do? He stretched forth his hands. Because Jesus didn't call Peter where he wasn't. Come on, somebody. Jesus was already where Jesus called him. Oh, that should be a word from somebody. He's calling you out because he's already there. He's calling you to that business because he's already there. He's calling you to that new job because he's already there. And if you begin to sing, don't worry. You will not finish. He will catch you. you won't finish. Philippians 1 and 6 says, being confident. So that's wrong with some church folk right now. We so humble, we don't have no confidence. Yeah. We so humble that we don't think that we ought to be blessed and we ought to be anointed, that we ought to walk into God's glory. But he called you to be blessed. He came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Why would he say exceeding abundantly? I don't know about you, but I want exceeding. I want abundantly. I want above all that I can ask or think. I'm going to walk in the confidence. Hebrews 10 and 35. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence, which has a great recompense of reward. Is my confidence in me? No, by no means necessary, but it's in the word of God. It's in what he said about me, and it's who he said I am. I'm walking in that confidence, and this is a confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything, when you go to prayer, you can't go to prayer scared. You can't go to prayer nervous. Confidence. This is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. But he that begin a good work in you will continue it until the day of Jesus Christ. What makes you think God is going to quit blessing you? Who told you that lie? Come on, talk to me. Hallelujah. Who told you that God is through using you? Who told you that God has not called you? Who told you? Who told you that? Didn't he confront Adam about that very thing? Who told you you were naked? Who told you you couldn't do it? Who told you you couldn't be blessed? Who told you I didn't call you? Who told you that? Remember what God says about you. As I bring my sermon to a close, or as I bring it in, we're going downhill now. We already reached the peak of the mountain. We're going down. And I want to talk about the four ways that you can overcome contradictions. I want to talk about four simple ways that you can overcome your contradiction, the thing that is opposing you. The thing that is in your face and won't go away. The thing is there that when you wake up, is there. When you lie down, it's there. When you go to work, it's there. Even if you look your spouse in the face, it might be there. When you look your kids in the face, it's there. When you look outside at your neighbor, it's there. Contradictions are everywhere. Don't fool yourself. Don't let nobody make you think that everything is well all the time, because we're all fighting something. We all got to fight the good fight of faith. We all got to endure that hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, hallelujah, the Bible said, think it not strange concerning these fiery trials, which is to try you as though some strange thing is happening. Why you think it's unusual for your marriage to go through? Why you think it's unusual for your money to be funny? Why you think it's unusual that your body can get sick? You are no different than all of us here on this earth. Hallelujah. You got to overcome the contradiction. That's what you have to learn to do. Just overcome it. Not run from it. Not tuck your tail. Overcome. Number one, keep expecting. If you're going to overcome contradictions, keep expecting. Let's go to 1 Kings 18. 1 Kings 18, verse 41 through 46. We're going to talk about Elijah just for a minute. Keep expecting. Verse 41 says, and Elijah said to Ahab, go, eat and drink, for there is a sound of heavy rain. Let me say first that your faith must be spoken without any signs. You got to learn how to speak faith when there is no signs, when there is no kind of sign that it will happen. Elijah went to Ahab because he heard something. He heard something on the inside of him that caused him to speak it on the outside without any evidence that it was going to happen. That's the kind of faith God looking for. That when you hear him speak, you'll be able to go to mama and say, mama, this is what I heard God say. She said, girl, you done lost your mind. Well, no, mama, you lost yours, because I'm about to see the glory of God. Your faith must be spoken without any signs. Why is positive confession good? Because faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Romans 10, 17. So you must learn to feed your own ears. Ooh, hallelujah. It's good that you tuned in today and you're getting a word from the Lord, but guess what? The camera's going to go off and the lights is going to go off and the service is going to end and Monday mornings is coming. And guess what? The same devil that you had to fight Friday, now it's come Monday is coming again. But you got to learn to feed yourself. You got to learn how to speak out the word of God. Speak it in your own ears. You can't wait till Sunday morning to hear a word. You can't wait to a Zoom call sometime. Sometime you need an emergency word. Hallelujah. Verse 42 says, so Ahab went off to eat, and he climbed up to the top of Mount Carmel. Elijah climbed up to the top of Mount Carmel, bent down to the ground, put his face between his knees. You know what that means? He was praying. He said to his servant, go and look toward the sea. And he went up and looked. There is nothing. That was his report. There is nothing. But I heard a sound. There is nothing. Contradiction. You heard a sound, but there is nothing. And he said seven times, Elijah, go back. Expectation. Help me, Holy Ghost. There is nothing. Contradiction. But he said, go back, expectation. How many times he went back? Seven times. God want to know, do you believe me still when there is nothing? When there is see nothing days? When you don't see no improvement in your marriage? No improvement with your boss? No improvement on the job? No improvement within yourself? No improvement in your career? It's just a dry season. Ain't nothing happening. There's nothing there. But in, on the inside, you hear the thundering. You hear the lightning. You hear God's word. But when you go look at your circumstance, there is nothing. But what is God saying? Go back. Keep looking. Keep expecting. Why did Elijah keep expecting with no sound of change, no sign of change? Why did he keep expecting? Because the sound kept his faith alive. That sound. You got a sound in you? Has God given you a word? Come on here. See, if you ain't connected to the true vine, come on, the source of all sources, and if you waiting on somebody to give you a word, that ain't a sound. The sound comes when you connect to the source of the sound, the source of the word. You got to learn to get a word from God for yourself. So when all hell break loose, you can stand on the sound. The sound to keep you going. The sound to keep you. Y'all remember that commercial about the Energizer Bunny? That when the commercial was over, the Energizer Bunny was still going around like this. Come on here. Hallelujah. And that's how you got to be when the word get in you. That's how you will be when a good word get in you. Not just a surface of the word, not just, ooh, that was a good word. No, let it get down on the inside, and you will keep going back until God do what he says he will do. The seventh time the cloud of a man's hand arose from the sea. He got a manifestation. Why? Because he kept expecting. Don't let what you see fool you. Because even when God manifests you sometime, it don't always look like what you think it should look like. When she start changing, she just may say, I'm sorry, and that's it. She may not change yet. Come on, somebody. But he said, I'll turn the small cloud into a heavy rain if you trust me. Hallelujah. If you believe that I gave you the sound. Can I tell you, somebody needs to know that you heard right. Help me, Holy Ghost. You heard right. God said, you've been hearing some things from me. This message is confirmation that you heard right. And God wants you to keep expecting. Keep expecting. Let's go to number two. The second thing you need to do if you're going to overcome contradictions, you got to keep growing. You got to keep growing. Growing. Matthew 13. Let's go there. Matthew 13, verse 24. Let's talk about the wheat and the tares. Verse 24 says, in another parable, he put unto them saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. I got to pause right there. Because somebody needs to know that, guess what? You are good seed. Hallelujah. I don't know what kind of mistakes you've made, but you are a good seed. I don't know what hurts you've been through, but you are a good seed. You may have went through a divorce, but you're still the good seed. You're God's good seed. He planted you here. He put you here despite of your mistakes. The Bible said the clay was marred in the hand of the potter, not outside his hand, but he kept on making it. Oh, hallelujah. God is still making you, and you are good seed. Touch yourself and say, I'm good seed. I'm good stock. I'm from a good God, and he calls me good. As a matter of fact, after he made man, he said it was very good. You can touch yourself and say, I'm very good. I don't care what somebody else say about you. They saw the worst in you, but God can see the best in you. Hallelujah. There is a best in you. There is a prophet in you. There is a businesswoman in you. There is glory down on the inside of you. You are good seed. Somebody say, good seed. Good seed. If you're going to survive contradictions, you must know who you are in Christ. You are a good seed. Made mistakes, but I'm good seed. Fell flat on my face, but I'm good seed. You know why you're good? Because a righteous man falls 7 times, but he keep getting back up. That what makes God keep blessing you, because you have the audacity to come back after a mistake. He can turn your mistakes into miracles. I don't know who I'm preaching to, but I have to just stop right there, because some of you feel like you made too many mistakes. No, you didn't make enough, because God's grace is sufficient. Come on, talk to me, somebody. Hallelujah. You can't make enough mistakes with God. Hallelujah. The only thing you better not do is blaspheme the Holy Ghost. Just don't blaspheme. Come on. Hallelujah. You good. Verse 25. But while men slept, his enemy came. So tear among those wheat and went his way. Hallelujah. Sometimes we just have to accept that things will happen beyond our control. Yes, 1 Peter 4:12 said, beloved, think it not strange concern these fiery trials which are to try you, as though some strange thing has happened to you. Have you ever had something that happened that you just couldn't control, that you couldn't stop from happening? But don't worry, you got a God that can stop it from happening. You got a God to make all things work together for good. Yes, he will. All your help cometh from the Lord. Did you just hear that little three-letter word a couple of times out of the mouth of two or three witnesses? Every word shall be established. All your help cometh from the Lord. He'll deliver you from all your fears. All things work together. Somebody needs to know that no matter what your all is, he can do it all. Hallelujah. Glory to his holy name. Verse 26, it said, but when the blade was sprung up and he brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares also. He was going real good. He was growing real good. Then all of a sudden, tares popped up in his view. Contradictions popped up. So the servant of the household said, the servant of the household came and said unto him, sir, did thou not sow good seed in thy field? Because sometimes it'll make you question God when you're going good and then it just start going bad. You just say, Lord, should I have married this person? Or is this marriage over? Or should I just leave this job? Or should I just walk away from this because something ain't right? Hallelujah. I know it was going good for a while, but now all of a sudden it's going bad. That's because there's a contradiction popping up in your situation. But you are still good seed no matter what's happening. He said unto them, verse 28, an enemy has done this. The servant said unto him, wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? In other words, he said, you want me to go get them up? Want me to go do something about it? But he said, nay. Now, this is a time where you need to be still. Touch your neighbor, say, be still, be still. If you're at home, just touch yourself. I gotta be still. I gotta be still. This ain't no time to get in no fight with people. This ain't no time to snap on the boss. This ain't no, because you'll lose your job. Talk to me. Hallelujah. You can't blame nobody but your mouth if you do that. Be still. Nay, be still. I know the terror's jumping up in your life. I know she's acting crazy. I know he ain't. He acting crazy. I know everybody's crazy, but nay, leave it alone. Leave him alone. Come on, talk to me. Go like Jesus did. Go up to the mountain apart. Who am I talking to? Instead of arguing with folk, go apart and pray. Go up to the mountain with Jesus. Get up there on that mountain and lay before God. Do like Elijah did. Go put your faith between your knees and cry out to the Most High. Leave it alone. This ain't no time to move now. This is a time to be still. Be still. Leave it alone. Don't touch it. Don't try to fix it. See, you can't fix people. How you gonna fix somebody when you can't even fix yourself? Help me, Holy Ghost. Paul said, "This that which I would do, I do not. And that which I want to do, I don't do it." He said, "It's no longer I, but who can deliver me from this body? I can't even fix myself. So how can I fix you?" You can't fix what God ordained anyway. If he ordained the tear, you just got to put up with it. Look at verse 30. Let them both grow together until the harvest. What you need to understand about tears. Number one, the tear never prevented. The tear never prevented the wheat from growing. Sometimes you have to look the tear in the face and keep growing. Give me about 5 more minutes. I'll be done. Sometimes you have to look the tear in the face and keep growing. Anointing and opposition, let them both grow together. Power and pain, let them both grow together. Friends and foes, let them both grow together. Strengths and your weaknesses, let them both grow together. The truth and the lies, let them both grow together. Have you ever had a lie on you and you couldn't fix it? Let them both grow together. Your talents and your tears, your prosperity and your problems, love and hate is in the world, but the Bible said let them both grow up. He's going to do the separating. Number three, let me move on. Number three, you got to keep serving. You got to keep serving. Despite of all that Joseph encountered, God gave him a dream. And that dream led him to a whole lot of contradictions. God gave you a dream. God gave you a dream. But you're dealing with contradictions. He gave you a business contradictions. He gave you a spouse contradiction. He gave you children contradictions. He gave you some money contradictions. He called you contradiction. Oh, God gave you a dream, but you gotta live with some contradictions. But let Joseph teach you a lesson on how to overcome contradictions. He served his way through the contradictions. See, he didn't stop serving. He didn't quit like some church folk do. They just get mad and leave the church and leave the spouse and leave the job. Sometimes God is challenging you to stand still. Sometimes God is trying to stretch you where you are to make you better, not bitter, to make you bigger, not smaller. God said you got to serve your way out. Joseph's brothers hated him. Genesis 37, but he served them in the field. Verse 37, chapter 37, verses 13 through 14. Then he went over to Potiphar's house after that was done. You thought he would be done. You thought he would give up, but no, he starts serving Potiphar in chapter Genesis 39, verses 1 through 4. And he ended up being falsely accused, which led him to prison. He hit rock bottom in Genesis 39, 20 through 23, but he served in prison and found favor in the sight of the warden. And there he met two men, the butler and the baker, and you would think he don't want to talk to nobody about the Lord. The Lord ain't been good to me. The Lord hurt me. The Lord allowed me to lose a loved one. The Lord allowed me to lose my job. My marriage is in trouble. But no, not Joseph. Joseph's still loving folk through that storm. He's serving and even witnessed and prophesied to them, and one of them end up getting out and going back to his position, but he was forgotten. But now here comes Joseph one more time. because the very one that forgot him remembered him. And sometimes God will put your life on hold. Now, hallelujah, he'll put it on hold temporarily so he can put it in, push it fast forward. Come on here. And so when Joseph went up to Pharaoh's house, he interpreted the dream. And in Genesis 39 through 40, the Bible says, then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has made it known to you, there is none so discreet and wise as you. You shall be in charge of my palace. And hallelujah, how he overcome. Through that, through all of that suffering, he served his way out. You need to serve your way out. Quit quitting and serve. Quit feeling sorry for yourself and serve. Quit feeling sorry for yourself and reach out and help somebody else. My final point is keep seeking. Keep seeking. Keep seeking. If you're going to overcome contradictions, when you really want something from God, you must get prepared to fight contradictions. Because they're all around you. This type of contradiction comes in the form of negative people that will spew out discouragement, doubt, and fear. Let's go to Luke 18, verse 35, and I'm done. Luke 18, verse 35, this is about the blind man. And it came to pass that he was come nigh unto Jericho, and a certain blind man sat by the wayside begging. And hearing the multitudes pass by, he asked what it meant. And they told him that Jesus of Nazareth passed by. And he cried, saying, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And they which went before rebuked him. Now the folk out there seeing this man blind and seeing he's in need and seeing that he have help rebuked him, that he should hold his peace like he wasn't good enough to cry out to Jesus. Don't let nobody make you think that you're not good enough to cry out to Jesus, that you're not good enough to come to Jesus, that you're too bad for him, that you've done too many bad things that he can't forgive you. You are just right for the grace of God. And Jesus, the Bible says in verse 39, and they which before him rebuked him that he should hold his peace. But guess what happened? That was a contradiction. But he cried so much more. Hallelujah. Thou son of David, have mercy on me. See, that's what you need to do when folk try to doubt what God said to you. You need to speak it even louder. You need to prophesy it even louder. You need to testify it even louder. You need to declare it even louder. You need to put it on a billboard. You need to put it on a poster. You need to put it on your front door. So when they come to your house, they know where you stand. They know you trust God. They know you believe God. You need to cry out the more. No matter what kind of negativity people are spewing out of their mouth, trying to get you to stop believing God, girl, that don't make sense. He can't do that. He won't do that for you. There's no way that can happen. There's no way you can open up a business right now. There's no way God's going to heal that. That's not going to happen. He can't restore that marriage. It can't happen. But he cried out the more. Don't let people's unbelief stop you from getting your miracle. Do whatever it takes. Whether they believe it or not, whether they encourage you or not, whether they can see it or not, you keep crying out. And the Bible said in verse 40, and Jesus stood. That means he stopped in his tracks. In other words, God takes notice on resilient faith. Not that kind of faith that's hiding in a corner and afraid. No, you believe in secret. He don't want that Nicodemus faith that only works when you're a baby. But when you are full grown in Christ, you're going to have to step up and step out and believe God. Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God some praise in this house. Everybody that's in here with me, stand on your feet. Come on here. We're done. Overcome. Overcome your contradictions. I don't know what you're facing, but I pray the Holy Ghost has arrested your doubts. The Holy Ghost has arrested all your fears and has put them on lockdown. Come on here. and let your faith arise, child of God. You are a child of God. You are the good seed. Hallelujah. Somebody's tuned in right now. You've been down on yourself. You've been down on yourself. You've been down. You was ready to give up. You even contemplated killing yourself. You've been in a depressed state for a long time. But it's your season. It's your time to arise and shine. For your light has come, and the glory of the Lord is risen. There's somebody sick in their body. Touch it right now. Touch that area of sickness right now. The healing of the Most High is upon you right now. What the medicine cannot do, the Holy Ghost is going to do it. Touch it right now with your hand. Don't wait on the pastor. Don't wait on the elders. Don't wait on put it on. Put your hand on it right now and say, heal me, Jesus. Just say it. Heal me, Jesus. Heal me, Jesus. Heal me. And in Jesus' name, it shall be done. There's somebody right now, you need a manifested word. A word that will manifest itself. You've been waiting on God to open up a door for you. You've been waiting on a job opportunity. Can I tell you, it's coming right now. In the name of Jesus, he said, I'll open up the door that no man can close. Get ready right now. Go back. I felt that for somebody. Go back. I know there was nothing, but go back. Go back. The Holy Ghost said, go back. Go back. Go back. We thank you right now. Miracles in relationships. Miracles in relationships. Not just marital relationships, but family relationships. The Holy Spirit says, hallelujah, I've given you the power to mend it. Be obedient and mend it, and I'll fix it. But I need your cooperation. I need you, hallelujah, I'm going to use you to fix it. I'm going to use you to mend that broken relationship. Overcome the contradictions. Look the terror in the face and said, I'm going to still grow. I'm going to still make it. I'm going to still arise. I'm going to still become. I'm going to still do what God called me to do, because I am an overcomer. Father, we thank you. And if you're not saved today, if you don't know Jesus, if somebody right now that's online that you have backslid. I know it. You have backslid from the Lord. But the Lord says, I'm married to the backslider. The Lord says, you left me, but I never left you. You in tears right now because you know I'm right. You know it's right. You in tears because that's the Holy Spirit on you right now. That's the Holy Spirit right now wrapping himself like a blanket all around you, wrapping that grace all around you, wrapping his love all around you because he wants you to come home. It's time to come home. And those of you that's been ready to walk out the door, close that door. Where are you going? There's nothing out there. But everything is in the house. Everything is in Jesus. Everything you need. I know it's hard, but everything is in Jesus. I know it ain't easy, but he'll never leave you nor forsake you. He said, I'll be with you always. Even to the end of time. So backslider, and those that are not saved, I want you to just repeat this after me and say, Lord, I'm giving myself to you. The first thing is the first contradiction I'm going to overcome is myself. That's the first contradiction I'm going to overcome, Lord, is me. I return to you. I'm closing the door to backsliding, and I'm going to stay at home. I'm coming home in the name of Jesus. And Father, I pray for all of the saints. It's under the sound of my voice. Healing. Healing in that home. Healing in that home. Healing in that home in the name of Jesus. I want that couple right now that's struggling, hold hands with your spouse. If your spouse is not there and you believe in that marriage, get a picture of them. Grab something tangible about them or her and hold it right now. If you believe God to overcome, is there something in you that still believes in this marriage? I want you to trust God right now because he will heal. He is going to heal it. In the name of Jesus. For those of you that are financially destitute, it's your season. Psalms 115, 114 says, the Lord shall increase you more and more. God is finna open up financial doors for you. Get your hands on your pocketbook right now. Get your hands on your checkbook. Get your hands on your wallet right now. You've been giving, you've been sowing. It's time to see your harvest. It's time for the word to become flesh for you. Get ready to step off into some financial miracles. You're about to overcome this contradiction. You say, Lord, I've been giving and giving and giving, but I ain't seeing nothing. But God said, here come the cloud. Here come the cloud you've been waiting for. Here come the cloud. Now, it may not look like what you expect, but receive it. Because that small cloud is going to turn into a heavy rain. Can you trust Jesus today? We love you, Lord. We thank you for our pastors. We thank you for these water walkers. We thank you for our church family. We are family. We thank you for the love in this family. We thank you for the faith in this family. We thank you for keeping Live Free alive during this coronavirus. We're going to come out better and stronger than we've ever been. The terror may be in our face, but we're going to keep growing, God. As a church family, we're going to keep growing. We're going to keep preaching. We're going to keep singing. We're going to keep serving. We're going to keep seeking. We're going to keep expecting, God. Because we're going to live out the name you gave us, Live Free. We're going to be free. In the name of Jesus, we thank you and we give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. We are so thankful that you have joined us today. All of you that are here as well, thank you for coming. On behalf of our pastors, Pastor Terrell Taylor and a very lovely Tara Taylor, they'd like to thank you for all of your support, all of your not only physical support, but your financial support. God is so good. We are so excited that God is blessing our pastors and laid on his heart to reopen the building. We're going to take the necessary precautions, trust me, to make sure everyone is safe. And we're just going to have some church, family. We're going to have some church. When you come to the house of the Lord, when God opened it up for you, you should be running in, ready to receive something from the Lord. Until next time, until this same time next week, we want you to tune back in to hear another awesome word and have another awesome experience with us here at Live Free Church. God bless you, and you have a fantabulous week.
We hope you enjoyed today's message and pray that you experience the freedom God has for you through his Son, Jesus Christ. John chapter 8, verse 36 says, "If the Son gives you freedom, you are free." If you would like more information about Live Free Church, please visit us on the web at www.livefreechurch.org.